Being humble and being patient are the most important qualities which a successful person should have. And today we are going to meet one of such personality who has been president of Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. He has been committee member of various organizations like SEBI. He has been on board of directors of various big companies. He is a very humble personality of our CA fraternity. So let's come and see who is this, the amazing man and the personality of CA profession. Let's come and see who is this. Nilesh Vikamsey, and let's learn from his wisdom and experience what we can learn in our future journey. So sir, thank you so much for being here. My question is, KKC have been associated with their clients for almost two generations, but nowadays what happens, people change their CA just because of fees or some other reasons. So what it takes actually to keep their clients so long time and serve them regularly?
First of all, thanks Shubham for having me on your interview, and by which I can share my experiences, and if it benefits any of the chartered accountants or the budding chartered accountants, it will be a effort worth the while.
Absolutely.
Coming to the client relationship, multi-generational client relationship, we have got a few clients whom we have been serving for multi-generations.
Yes.
Birla's being one of them, and I can only share is first and foremost is your service has to be good. Whatever you're doing is audit, whether it's tax, whether it is indirect tax or any other activity you're doing for the client. So there has to be honesty in the purpose with which you're serving the client, number one. Number two, your interpersonal relationships have to be good. There are situations in audit where sometimes we have to take a tough stand on many matters, but till the time it is only profession related and there's no personal, you know, issues arising out of it. And there is a good understanding of the professionalism between the client and you, I think the relationship can go on and on. And that's what we have found, especially with some of our clients, which we are a sort of in the multi-generations, where like we have been working very sincerely with the client. Number two, our relationship not only with the promoters, but with the executives, that has to be, you know, on a good wicket. Keeping the professional standards which you have, not sort of tampering with the professional standards which you have, but if you're honest, I think the relationship will continue. That's what my belief
yes.
is.
So it should not be just transactional in nature.
Absolutely.
It should be a interpersonal connection. It's
absolutely.
Emotional connection with the client.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely.
So thank you, sir, for that. And in one of your video, you mentioned that it is very important to take care of our health as a chartered accountant because our job is of sedentary nature.
Absolutely.
So, but what happens sometimes, sir, many people leave late from the office and then in the morning they say, okay, I left late from the office, so I can't go to gym or I can't focus on my health. So what is your advice to such people?
I think I'm the right example for that. My father, who himself was a chartered accountant and very good on the physical fitness as well as spiritual fitness, used to always keep on advising us, myself, Kamlesh, my elder brother Ketan, you know, all of us are chartered accountants, that you take care of your physical and spiritual health. And not that we were sort of disrespecting him, but at the young age, ego kaam ka nasha hota hai. There is a passion for the work which you do. And I give my own example. Between 96 and 99, 3 years, I was completely physically inactive. So work, always, you know, passionate for the work and all. In 1999, I suffered a slip disc. And so learned the hard way what is the importance of the physical fitness. And from 99 onwards, I have been sort of trying to keep my physical regime reasonably, you know, on a even keel. Even despite I've been president of ICAI, I've been director of a number of companies. So there are periods where for maybe 8, 10 days or maybe 15 days, you're completely out of the physical routine because of the sheer pressure. The presidentship and vice presidentship was a very, you know, I would say, intense sort of a role.
Yes.
And despite that, almost used to take out time. So your idea has to be assuming you're off the physical regime for 8, 10 days, but you need to come back.
Yes.
So what I used to do is maybe say 8, 10 days I've been out of the physical regime. Even at the extent of going late to the office, I used to sort of say go for a walk or a swim or do yoga or whatever, just to see that you break that jinx. So many times it happens that, you know, there are late sitting during peak periods and all. So it's possible that 8, 10 days you're out of the physical regime, but on the 11th day, the moment that peak period is off, you have to, you know, get back. I think for us as chartered accountants, our health is a plant and machinery.
Yes.
So unless you are going to maintain it, at the young age you will not find issues with that. But in case you are not careful at a later age, this is going to be a dampener as far as your professionalism is concerned. So I would strongly recommend, please take care of your physical activity. Do walking, do yoga, do gymming, do swimming, whatever you find to each his liking.
True.
So whatever you like, do it, but do at least one or maybe more things what you like. Don't go away without it.
That's true. Because of hectic schedule, don't be lazy to work out so that you can extract more time. So you need to focus on your health. As sir mentioned, he suffered from sleep disc. So it's better to keep your health at parity with your work so that your family and you does not suffer. So sir, you talked about spiritual health as well. And I know you are a Vipassana practitioner and trustee over there as well. So how Vipassana has helped you in your professional journey?
Vipassana has helped me tremendously. What I am today, I would say a huge part of the credit goes to Vipassana. I had an ex-article of mine, Mukund Soni, a trainee with me way back in 1985. He was after me, Nilesh, why you do Vipassana? I used to listen to him at that point of time and sort of say this is a thing to be done post 50.
Yes.
And I was sort of ignoring him, I was appreciative we need to have spiritual, you know, growth. Then one day he insisted that I attend Guruji's lecture at Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. I heard Guruji Satyanarayan Goenkaji at Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan in 1986.
Okay.
And I heard him, I stepped out of the hall at Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan and told Mukund, my colleague, that I am going to do Vipassana ASAP. But that time, the practice had grown a lot and I couldn't take out time. The first Shibir I did was in 1989.
Okay.
That was after my engagement and before my marriage. That time Vipassana was not much known.
Yes.
And I can only share with you is, number one, the first physical, very apparent benefit it gave me is it removed my short-temperedness. I was very, very short-tempered. So the person to whom I used to fire, of course, whatever his position would be awkward, but I used to take almost an hour to rewind myself from the anger which I had created. Not that I don't get angry, but now I do get angry to get things done, but it's more a show of anger. I don't get angry within. So that was the first physical benefit. Second, in lives, a lot of ups and downs. I have reached the presidentship of institute, chairman of a private bank called Federal Bank. I was there for some 8 years in the bank. Then number of board positions. So in lives, there are a lot of ups and downs. I have seen some personal tragedies also. Vipassana has helped me keep in good stead, in the sense mentally. Otherwise, if something is very good, you start jumping with joy, and you know you don't. And when something is not so good with you, you go get into a depression or a regret and all. Vipassana has helped me remain equanimous to the best extent possible, and the equanimity has brought, you know, so your personal life, your professional life, your social life. All the aspects, you are more balanced and you don't, you're not reactionary at that point of time, despite ups and downs. So I think that has been the major, benefit, and I can owe a lot of things what I am today, not a lot, almost substantial, is thanks to the Vipassana meditation, which I have been doing and practicing. Of course, I want to practice more of it, but whatever I have done till now has helped me a lot in all my life.
That's great, because I've been also Vipassana. So I understand how effective it is for our mental and physical health.
Yes.
Yes.
And I would strongly recommend each and every person at least try it out once. It's a 10-day course, of which 9 days you are mourn, in a noble silence. You can talk to the teachers there. And I would strongly urge and earnestly request each and whether he's a teenager, whether it's he's a young person of the in the 20s or even at any stage of life, never read it. Start it. If you find you like it, then you may do it more. It's completely free of charge. There is no charge to Vipassana. Yes. So I would strongly urge that people do Vipassana.
Yes. And most probably after their hectic schedule, like tax holidays and this date.
No, your professionally, your work will improve. Thinking your work will improve, your productivity will improve, your personal life, family life will improve. I think in all across it will be positive.
Yes, well, thank you so much, sir, for sharing this. So, as we are having conversation, so I realize you also held some, meeting in every Thursday. So, what is that about and what is the objective behind it?
Thanks, Shubham, for drawing that attention to me. At our office, on every Thursday evening, we hold a group Vipassana sessions where whoever has done Vipassana within the office can sit. There are some people who come from outside and we have group meditation. So the group meditation helps, assuming for some week or maybe 15 days or 1 month, I am out of the practice of Vipassana. So it helps, sort of reconnect. It gives a lot of strength at that point of time. And not only the evening Thursday sessions, which we do of Vipassana, every day in our office at 3 o'clock, there is a noble silence where people come and sit in the boardroom which you are seeing right now, and they can do their prayers. We just close the lights, people close their eyes, they can do prayers, they can do whatever they want for 5-10 minutes. And then we close it with a Mangal Maitri or some good, spiritual bhajan or this thing. And so it's a midday break. You've got a hectic day, so it helps the next few hours to go in a much more balanced fashion and remove the stress from the our day-to-day work.
Wow, sir, that's amazing. And people will be loving it because they have so much pressure during peak period.
Absolutely. Yes. So every day 10-15 minutes of a break where people close their eyes, do prayer, do Vipassana, do whatever they want. That is open to all. The Thursday evening Vipassana session is only for Vipassana meditators within the office and outside the office. They can come and meditate.
So if you are the one who wants peace in life, here is the chance. You can come here and join this meditation so that you can achieve more in life. Okay.
This is only open to Vipassana meditators, the evening sessions. So if you have done once, then you can come.
Yes.
Yeah.
So sir, my next question is, most of the young chartered accountants nowadays, they keep changing their jobs in anticipation that they will get more happiness in other job, or maybe they try to go out of country. So what would you say and what is your view on this?
See, there are different aspirations of different people. Going out of the country, people generally want to sort of earn more, maybe earn in dollars or pounds or dirhams, and do some more saving for their families back home. So that's nothing wrong with that. We have got about around on record about 10,000 chartered accountants of India, but actually there are more than 25,000. A lot of people have not shifted their addresses there. We have got about 36 chapters outside India, the ICAI. And as far as the youngsters are concerned, changing of jobs, I would only recommend that. I've seen people jumping a lot from various jobs. I don't know whether how far of them they've been successful, but I find that some stability within the organization also can increase their career graph rather than jumping. The crux is whether you are liking your job. If you are loving your job, my recommendation would be, please don't jump. Even if somewhere the remuneration is a little bit low, high, you should be loving your job. Then it will not be a job at all.
Yes.
So that would be my suggestion. If you are somewhere there only for the money, you are not liking your job, then possibly you may change. So I would not be, as far as the larger firms are concerned, there has been a huge stress also, the work stress, the work-life balance. So that I think as an organization also, they should be addressing that. I keep on hearing a lot of things. There is a work, struggle within our organization also, especially during peak periods, audit periods or tax periods. We do late sitting, but we try to have as much as possible a work-life balance other than those specific periods. So for audit people, the peak period will be different, and for tax would be different. But leaving that apart, that is part and parcel of a job. But you should be liking your job. If you like your job, then that even those late settings will not be a, hassle. So
when your passion comes in,
absolutely,
there is no fatigue which comes in between.
And you balance that with your family, assuming your family life is there. So other than those peak periods of say 10, 15 days, 20 days at the month ends, say whether it's September or October or whatever.
Yes.
But unfortunately today what has happened is, especially people who are having their own practice, the individual practice, maybe sole proprietor or maybe smaller firms, the number of deadlines, whether it's a GST deadline or a direct tax deadline, returns, TDS, GST returns, then the audits, I think they are finding it difficult to keep pace. So there my suggestion would be, if you, it's possible, team together with people, specialize, so that you've got some deadlines, but you don't have all the deadlines with you.
Yes.
So which may have a challenge as far as your work-life balance is concerned. So you team up with people, you specialize in some areas, so you will face the deadlines of those areas, but not all the deadlines of all the areas. So that you try to balance out.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing that. So related to this, when people shift to big fours or some big corporates, what happens? People say, we learn a lot in small firms, but they don't pay us. So that's why we shift to big fours, and we end up in frustration, more work, more, you know, everything of more and less, this life, family time, this, that. So what do you think, whether with this approach, small firm who are not willing to pay their chartered accountants, can they become big eight, which was the dream of Mr. Narendra Modi?
Shubham, my belief is today the packages, of course, in the CA firms are reasonably good. Yeah, the larger firms will be paying more because they got more volume of work.
Yes.
But generally, there is one concept which I've heard, especially in the MNCs. I'm so not only saying the CA firm, but even non-CA firms. It is called 1-2-4. It is, they hire one person, they give them,
2% salary?
2 times the salary, and they take 4 times the work.
Yes.
My belief is now that ratio has become 1-10. They hire one person, gives 2 times salary and 10 times work. So these are all on the lighter side. There's no difference. There are business models which people follow. Again, I said their focus has to be work-life balance, and the CA firms also, I would say the mid-size and the smaller firms also today, the work pressure is such that all of them have increased their remunerations, mm-hmm. especially in a place like Mumbai, and I'm told even in Tier 2 and Tier 3, depending on that cost of living in those areas, I think chartered accounts are getting reasonably good, you know, starting package. Maybe it is less than some of the larger firms, but if you look at overall work-life balance and the personal growth and the areas of their interest, I think their growth, their variety will be huge. The more you join the larger firms, there will be more compartmentalization of the work, more narrower of the work.
Mm.
In a mid-size or smaller firm, the variety of work is large in whichever area you're doing. So that's a trade-off which each person has to decide for himself, whether what he wants to do. So the balance between money and job satisfaction, I think it's always like a tightrope walk where you have to balance in some side. So I think to each is, there's no right or wrong in that. One has to evolve and decide what he wants to do.
So every person who is starting their career, they should at least decide first what they actually want to do.
Absolutely.
And not seeing other people, okay, my friend is doing this, let me go into this. Because this, after some time people feel, okay, I'm getting money, but there is no satisfaction.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And this leads to frustration. I've talked to so many chartered accountants, and they are confused. Like, what should I do? Whether should I go for audit or tax? Because they don't see other profiles. So what do you think, sir? Are CAs only made for audit and tax, or they can pursue their career in any of the field?
See, my belief is the CA training is so robust. So a person who has trained, done his practical training sincerely, I think he can do anything in life. And I can just give some examples. We have got Mr. Suresh Prabhu and Mr. Piyush Goyal, who have been ministers throughout. We have got Mr. Shekhar Kapoor, who is a film director.
Yes.
And forget all these leading, I'll just give an example of one of my ex-colleagues. She, fantastic, brilliant person, did her CA in the first attempt, and she is now gone to Paris to learn more about this pastries. She's becoming a pâtissier. I got a friend's daughter, she's a chartered accountant. She's running a pastry, pastry business.
Yeah.
So in my view, the CA gives a good grounding. It's a good all-round course. Just to give another example, the current MD of Ultratech Cement is a chartered accountant, and he was the chief manufacturing officer before he became the MD.
Okay.
The erstwhile MD has become the vice chairman of Ultratech Cement, the largest cement company. Incidentally, he is also a chartered accountant.
Okay, wow.
So chartered accountant being expert in the manufacturing of cement.
Yes.
I think you can just make out that what a chartered accountant can do, whether it's a pastry business, whether it is film direction. Pranav Roy is a good journalist, TV journalist.
Yes.
So I think our training is so good, you can do whatever you want. I got one of my neighbors, he was the marketing head of the mutual fund business of HDFC.
Okay.
Then he was the CEO of DLF Pramerica Mutual Fund. So from marketing, from a chartered accountant, then financial marketing, and then a CEO. So I think a competence is there. Yes. Whatever line, we have got that ability to learn in that particular line and scale up in that area.
CA degree is just an amplifier. It does not decide that whether you should go for audit or tax. Yeah. You can do whatever you want to do in your life.
Yes, absolutely.
This question is for CA firms, small and medium firms. Generally, they charge too less amount for their professional fees just to maybe retain clients, or maybe it has become practice that we charge only competitive price. If someone is leaving 1,000 rupees,
yeah,
so we only, let's say, 800 rupees just to retain that client.
I agree with you.
So, sir, how justifiable it is for our profession? This is very reputed and noble profession. How justifiable it is with people who are doing such kind of practice, and where does it lead to?
I agree with you, Shubham. This has been a bane for our profession, the undercutting of fees or the charging low fees compared to the work involved.
Yes.
But my belief is people are realizing it. Whether it's, and it's not only at the smaller firm level, even at the larger firm level.
Okay.
Believe me, it's across the whole spectrum.
Yes.
Like we have got interaction with the larger and the smaller firms also. And it's been a bane. But now I think a huge correction is happening. I'm just giving an example. With the larger firm, what is happening? They were initially not assessing, they were not doing the KYC of the clients properly. They know your client. They were not assessing the risk attached to an audit properly. Now with whatever examples, the scams which we are seeing, that has suddenly made people realize that they need to focus more on the KYC as well as the risk attached to a new client, on the systems and process front, on the how much audit risk they are taking. And that itself is helping, sort of adjusting the fee to a reasonable level now. Mm-hmm. That mad rush of accepting client at any rate, just for your volume growth, is tapering at a larger level. At the smaller firm level, what is happening now, the amount of increase in compliance is literally creating a problem. You know, whether it is income tax, you see the current individual returns also, the amount of information which is being asked for, or the GST, or the audits. In the audit, the amount of documentation which is required now.
Yes.
So all the way the time involved in doing the work has increased, and I think the people are realizing that.
Yes.
And that itself, of course, we have not been trained enough as far as this matter is concerned on the charging of fees.
Yes.
And I used to speak earlier on practice management. In fact, day after tomorrow, I got a webcast from the Institute on practice management, where I'm going to speak more on the
yes.
charging of fees also. That's one of the areas which I'm going to speak on. And we as a profession need to learn. And what is our man hour rate? Sometimes it is so pitiable. It may be less than a carpenter or a plumber.
Absolutely.
We are supposed to be so, I would say, literate crowds. I think it's time for all of us to introspect what we are doing and correct ourselves.
Absolutely.
And that is at each level, whether individual firms. And I think it's happening.
Yes.
My feeling is the sheer nature is forcing it to happen.
Yes.
The way the surroundings, the environment, whether it's the larger firms or totally the smaller okay. firms, that itself is putting pressure on readjusting this, and the costs are going through the roof.
Absolutely. Otherwise, they won't be able to survive in the market.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And as you mentioned, sir,
another thing I just want to point out today, earlier what used to happen, even a slightly, less quality was acceptable.
Mm.
And you could push through, whether it is the return filing, audit. Now, there is no way you can, you can reduce your quality. Your quality has to be top class, because you're going to get caught, whether it's income tax, GST, audits. So you need to give reasonably good time. You cannot do a sort of haphazard job. So if you're going to do that, you have to be, your time is going to go up for that particular assignment. You'll need to charge properly.
Absolutely, sir. Very
yeah.
well said. And as you mentioned, people are struggling between due dates. So maybe they can collaborate. Maybe
yes.
one specialized person in direct tax can collaborate
absolutely.
With other indirect tax specialists.
Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
They can collaborate and
become the larger firms.
The larger
That has to happen. There's no choice. That has to happen.
Yes.
And what is happening, another thing I want to point out, Shubham, is the rate of change in each and every act which I'm seeing currently has been unbelievable. Today, the government and the regulatory authorities, earlier, I'm saying 5 years back or 6 years back, before this government came, they're supposed to be very, very sort of, I would say, the change was very slow.
Yes.
Today, whether it is Companies Act, whether it is GST, whether it is income tax, the rate of change is, very, very fast, and it is beating the business and the profession both. Yes. The government is much more faster. Just to give one small case in point, which people are not realized, Companies Act, the 2000 Companies Act, one of the best in the world, the top corporate governance practices of UK, Canada, Australia, US was brought in. So one would have supposed that that act will remain stable for some time. The earlier act was brought in 1956, very few amendments, it remained for 70 years. This act, 2013 act, has already been amended in 2015, 2017, an ordinance came in 2018, which got 2-3 times it came to the parliament. And as that ordinance was getting passed in June 19, another amendment came from the Union Cabinet, okay, where of which CSR imprisonment, yes, was one of the key clauses, just to bring, and that was passed, in my opinion, if my memory serves me right, in less than 2 weeks, from Union Cabinet to Lok Sabha to Rajya Sabha President's Action. I have not seen any amendment to an act also getting passed in 15 days.
Yes.
Earlier, this used to be referred to the select committee, this, that, etc. So this just gives an indication. This is as far as the act is concerned. Now look at the rules. Under Companies Act, there are 44 set of rules which have come in 2014 and 15. They have been amended till March 19, I had tracked it, about 155 times.
Okay.
So that's the rate of change. So unless you're going to keep pace, whichever area, GST, I don't know how to talk, people, I know people have been practicing on GST. So every day there's a change.
Yes.
Companies Act, our focus has reduced because it has gone more to the company secretaries. I just want to draw attention on Companies Act also, the amount of change. And if you're doing audits, you need to keep pace with the Companies Act changes also for the company audits and all. So the rate of change has been huge.
Yes. And in GST especially, every day,
there is some change.
Yeah, people need to take care of what are the changes.
Yes.
Sir, what I have observed, another thing, when people become chartered accountant, they feel, okay, I've got this degree, and which is awesome because they have worked hard to get the degree. But after that, they stop developing their personal personality. They stop investing in their personal development, which is very essential in today's world, wherein technical knowledge is obviously important, but non-technical stuff is also important.
Yeah.
So how do you think CA should invest in their physical personality, their non-technical skills like public speaking, maybe writing skills, maybe presentation skills, whatsoever skills are there?
Again, you have hit the nail, Shubham. It's absolutely important, not only non-technical, soft skills as you call it,
yes,
public speaking, etc. So just to give my example, I had done a public speaking course maybe when I was in 11th, 12th, out of college, didn't do much. Then when I became a CA, I became a CA in 85.
Yes.
In 1990, I became a convener of a small study. That time there was no CP, it was just for self-study. Convener, so you know, right from introduction, vote of thanks, so you develop confidence in speaking on a dais with, again, in front of 25, 30, 50 people.
Yes.
After that, somewhere in 2001, I did a course called Business Consulting Studies in Jamnal Bajaj.
Yes.
So after almost 15 years of my, you know, practice, and which was not only soft skill, it was a lot of, you know, management related this thing, course. Then I did my DSA somewhere in 2003. So the influence, so one has to, even given a choice, of course the last 8-10 years has been very hectic, but given a choice, I would still want to go back as a participant somewhere in some of the courses. I'm looking at valuation, I'm looking at insolvency and some other courses. So sooner or later, I will be again going back as a student. And so one, that number, the technical learning has to be continuous, the soft learning, and you should grab opportunities.
Yes.
Either as conveners or in your own organization, if you can speak somewhere, smaller audiences,
yes,
developers, so your inhibitions start coming. Finally, it's a matter of practice. Practice makes a man perfect. So even soft skills, unless you may do a training, but unless you keep on speaking, that's not going to happen. And today, in today's world, if you have to be successful, this is one of the most important ingredients.
Yes.
Even if you've got slightly lesser technical knowledge, that you can always, you can check back and come back.
Yes.
But your interpersonal skills, you know, and your public speaking skills are very important.
Yes.
The feedback when I was a board of studies chairman, and later on when we were changing the course, from some of the industry which we got, is the chartered accountants are much more knowledgeable on technical this thing, but they are not problem solvers, whereas an MBA very low on technical knowledge, but is a problem solver. So he knows how to solve the problem. He'll take the help of a chartered accountant, engineer, doctor, and solve the problem. So that is the problem solving will happen if your soft skills are there, you'll interact with people, and you'll be able to solve problems. So problem solving is another key thing which we need to focus. See, we as auditors, we're always problem finders.
Yes.
Simultaneously, if you train yourself to give solutions, alternate solutions to the problems, I think your value will increase substantially.
Absolutely, because we are the people who can become business advisor to the client and not just being compliance partners.
Yeah.
We can give them the value which they are looking for. But for Absolutely. That, we need to be good at skills. And we need not complain that MBAs are better than CS. They are not. And there is no comparison, actually.
Absolutely. Right? They have got different skill set. We have got different skill.
And we can develop those skill set as well.
Absolutely.
As you mentioned.
Absolutely.
And Toastmaster is the one place which is very good for public speaking.
Yeah, I have heard about it.
Yes.
Which not
I recommend everyone.
True.
If they are not good, they should visit Toastmasters to improve that. So, sir, a CA should have many qualities if they want to become like successful people like you. But what is that one quality which you think is the most important for a chartered accountant?
One quality, just saying, would be very difficult. But I would say patience. Today, especially the younger generation, say want to be the, you know, whether the top CFO or the top CEO or the top investor almost overnight once they become CAs. And my belief is you should have patience, walk the path, have patience, success will be yours.
Yes.
Don't be impatient. Today you're graduated as a CA, you can't be a CFO of say Hindustan Unilever. But you need to walk, assuming you want to become CFO of Hindustan Unilever, you give it time, you walk on that path, you perform, have patience, and you'll definitely succeed. Success, you need to have a lot of patience for success. As I told you, there'll be ups and downs in life. But if you're patient, success will be yours.
Yes.
But continue to walk on that path.
And it is important to identify what you love to do, because otherwise you will
Absolutely.
End up in frustration and no work.
That's most critical.
Yes.
Loving the job you're doing, then it will not be a job at all. Yes. And then again, the success will be yours.
Absolutely, sir. And what would be your advice to people who are watching this interview right now?
As I told you, there are various traits. There's no one trait. Number one, you need to be honest and ethical. Today, ethics are at a huge premium, and you're seeing the way actions are happening across the country and across the world. So anything unethical is going to be found out sooner or later, and they're not going to survive. And today, using technology, you know, the integration which is happening. So ethics is one of the most important. Of course, we all are used to hard work. Persistence is another thing. As I told you, you need to be persistent till the time you succeed. Keep on, you don't know when the success will be there. You know, patience, I didn't mention. Need to be optimistic. You need to be very optimistic. And you need to work on the, life will give you opportunities.
Yes.
At that point of time, you're going to, give back, go back. Then the opportunity will not be yours. So when the opportunities come, you don't know when it'll come. Grab it, work hard. That time it will result in working more harder when the opportunities come. But that's what you'll have to do. You can't, for example, as I told you, when I was the vice president, I was already a chairman of Federal Bank.
Okay.
So the issue was whether I continue as a chairman. So that time my president, Mr. Devaraj, already told me, don't give up the chairmanship of Federal Bank. You are, very few people are chairman of a bank.
Yes.
So I sort of continued during at least that time the buck used to end at the president's level. But when I became president, I sort of sacrificed the chairmanship of Federal Bank, because that time presidentship of ICAI was more important.
True.
So you will keep on getting opportunities. So you need to sacrifice also sometimes.
Yes.
So that balancing will have to keep on happening. So when the opportunity comes, you become chairman of a bank. When the opportunity, you become president, you sacrifice your chairmanship also at that point of time. So again, as I told you, life is a tightrope walk. So you have to sacrifice somewhere. You have to grab the opportunity. When I became ICA, it was not an opportunity for us. It was a payback to the profession.
Yes.
Whether it is Vipassana, whether it is the profession, whether it is in the education field, like my father has always taught us that you need to pay back. What we are today is thanks to the profession. So the presidentship, the council, as a council member, whatever time we have given to the institute or the efforts is a payback to the profession. So I think that gratitude towards the society has to be there in whatever walks of life you are, and whatever success you have achieved in whatever walks, I always have that feeling of payback, and payback to the profession, in my view, is very important.
Sir, because we always take from our fraternity, from our society, but if we can give something to the society, that is of immense happiness and fulfillment.
Absolutely.
From inside.
And it's a must, in my view.
Yes.
We need to pay back.
Everyone should do it. So thank you so much, sir, for sharing your wisdom and your experience and how people can become better version of themselves. So thank you so much, sir, for your time.
Thank you.